church. So I heard there was some work to be done. So that's why I have the gloves on. Allison, I just want to thank you for such a warm welcome we've received. We definitely feel the fellowship here and the Lord's presence. So glad to be here. And speaking of fellowship, we actually met a fellow Ohio Buckeye. So we're actually from the Columbus area. So
OH!
Oh, had some people join there. It's actually not as tough of a crowd as I thought it would be. So, the scripture for this morning is Romans 12, 1 and 2. As I was thinking and praying about these verses, the message I could boil down was this: be soft in the Creator's hands. So, Romans 12, 1 and 2. Present your bodies a living and holy sacrifice, acceptable to God, which is your spiritual service of worship. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, so that you may prove what the will of God is, that which is good and acceptable and perfect. The picture coming to my mind was that of a glove. Notice I have two different gloves on here. This one, it's stiff. I can't bend my fingers. So, you know what I'm going to do with this glove? I'm going to take it off. It's still my glove, okay? And, you know, with leather gloves, you can actually soften them up. You put them out in the sun so the pores open up, and then you put oil on it. And take some time. It'll soften up, hopefully. If it's open, it receives the oil. In the meantime, I've got this nice flexible glove I'm going to use. Okay? So this metaphor was helping me understand what the Apostle Paul is saying here in Romans 12, 1 and 2. Okay? These verses start with the word therefore. So whenever I read scripture and I see that word, I have to ask myself the question, what's it there for? So he's making a conclusion based on what he has said before. If you read the whole book of Romans, it's actually a letter. So when it was received, the people would have read the whole letter at the same time. So you would have perceived this flow of thought. The last few chapters in Romans are a conclusion that Paul is making based on the first 11 chapters. So the first 11 chapters, he just talks about who God is, who we are, our need for a Savior, and the mechanics of that. Therefore, because of all that, there's a response. So I thought it would be helpful to walk through, to summarize the first 11 chapters. I've been trying to be as concise as possible. That way we can have that in our minds as we really expand on these two verses. So again, the glove, it's made for a hand. It's only useful if it submits to what the hand wants to do. So let's look at chapter 1. Chapter 1 summarized would be this. As I was reading, I was trying to be as concise as possible. It talks about the gospel. The gospel is a free gift of a righteous life in Christ. And he talks about how people have suppressed the truth in unrighteousness. The wrath of God is revealed from heaven against people who suppress the truth in unrighteousness. The truth about who God is. Gospel is that now we can escape God's wrath. If we refuse the gospel, we are under God's wrath, and we can expect that for eternity. So he's given us that escape, and then a new life to live. And he builds on that in Romans 2. He gives a little more detail on how there's rewards for obedience to God in this new life you have, and there's judgment for disobedience. Okay, Romans 3. Then he gets into discussing the law. The law actually shows us that we're justified by faith alone. No one can actually do the law. It's a standard by which God is showing us, this is the life I expect you to live, but it's not possible. So it shows us that we need to have faith in Christ. Justified by faith alone and Christ alone, and it's a gift of God's grace. Romans 4 gives us an example of that justification by faith. Actually, from the Old Testament, he discusses Abraham. If you're familiar with Abraham, you know, he's called the father of faith. He was the first patriarch, and Hebrews describes him as, you know, having faith. It says, by faith, Abraham went out into a land which he was to receive as a promised inheritance. Went out not knowing where he was going. So the new life that we are now to live by faith is one that we won't necessarily understand, but it's one of obedience. By faith, Abraham obeyed and went out. That was the word obey. And he went out not knowing where he was going. Okay? Chapter 5. Now justified by faith, we can live a life pleasing to God. It's Christ's very life. It's not just this life I make up for myself. Christ himself is living in us. Romans 6. The way we are to live specifically then, this quotes a verse in Romans 6, consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. So, consider. That's an important word. Yes, we have this new life, but we also have to consider this new life. It takes intentionality on our part. We are no longer living in sin. There's a former life that we've been rescued from, okay? Again, the gospel is the free gift of a righteous life in Christ. So now free from sin, let's be dead to it. Let's not turn back. But alive to God in Christ Jesus. So now we have our eyes fixed on him. Okay? And there's a warning in Romans 6 too. Romans 6:23 says, the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life. So again, there's this death. Life your own way is actually death. Then there's a free gift. Again, by God's grace, we have eternal life. And eternal life, it's a type of life. It's not just long life, forever life. It's Christ. It's the quality of the life, Christ's life, eternal. All right? Then chapter 7, he gets into how to overcome sin. It's through our union with Christ, him living in us, we can overcome sin. And it's important to remember then he goes on to say that if we try it by our own fleshly effort, we are going to be conflicted. We'll despair in our struggle to please God if we're doing it by our fleshly effort. Christ has freed us from the flesh. In other words, living life my own way, going after what I see fit, even thinking that I can follow God on my own effort, on my own terms. He's freed us from that. That's the only way we can overcome our present temptations, the things in the world that are influencing us that might cause us to sin. We're freed from that. And we cannot do it by our own fleshly effort. Really emphasizes in that Romans 7, then Romans 8 builds on that, talking about the Holy Spirit. How now, we have giving this new life, we can now live it by the power of the Spirit. And he says, we're children of God. The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are children of God. And we overwhelmingly conquer everything that could come against us through the love of Christ. So he's leading us in triumph. The Holy Spirit leads us as triumphant children of God. There is going to be suffering on earth. So we're triumphant in the midst of that suffering. Praise God. And the Holy Spirit empowers us to then obey God as well. So it's the empowerment to obey. And that is how we triumph. Okay? Chapter 9 seems to switch gears a little bit based on those truths. Now he turns to the discussion of God's chosen people, specifically Israel. And then he's saying that those outside Israel can now come to faith in the Messiah. So God's chosen people are those who come to faith. All right? Now, God is using everything to turn everyone to faith. Paul discusses this in 9 and 10, that the Gentiles, Greek, those who are outside of God's chosen people, Israel, have been turned to faith, now to turn God's people, Israel, back to him. So God is using everything to turn everyone to faith. Okay? Keep that in mind, then. Chapter 10 points out how Israel was trying to achieve this righteousness on their own. Okay, they had all this religiosity. They had these sacrifices they made. But it's only by faith. Everyone has access to God through faith. The question is, who is listening to him? Okay? In chapter 11, he gives this picture of a wild olive tree and a natural olive tree. The Gentiles were grafted in. So now there's this shared life. Some of the natural branches were cut off. Those who were not obedient, those people in Israel who do not have faith. So it's all faith. This is a tree of faith. Connection to the Lord through faith. So there's a warning to don't be proud because now you're God's chosen people. Because some of those natural branches, you know, Israel, were cut off because they didn't have faith. So you keep with the faith. There's a strong encouragement, exhortation in there. And chapter 11 then just ends with a very important thing for us to keep in mind. While we can't understand God's work, he's very mysterious, you know, with Israel, now we've been brought in, anyone who has faith, we have to remember that for him and through him and to him are all things, to him be the glory forever. And it does end with amen. Thank you. So then the end of chapter 11 is the conclusion of everything up to that point in the letter. To him be the glory forever. So everything he has described is for God's glory. We're beneficiaries, yes. But let's not forget that. It's for his glory. So to sum up, I'm going to try to put the first 11 chapters in a statement here. Through God's grace, all who believe and receive Christ's righteous life by faith in his reconciling work on the cross, now cooperating with the Holy Spirit, will share in Christ's eternal life as God's children. To the glory of God forever. Amen. Therefore, Romans 12. So let's turn to that again. Go to the next slide. The metaphor. We look at everything he's saying here. He says, by the mercies of God. So the metaphor was this. The glove is at the mercy of the hand. There was one that was hard, inflexible, not useful. Okay? This one has presented itself to the hand. Now, God is not looking for what we can do for him, except to submit to the life in us, to be flexible, to reach when he says reach, to do the work he wants us to do. We won't fully understand that, okay? So that is the thrust. I want to think about some specific ways walking through Romans 12, 1 and 2. So this will be our application after we go through some of the things in 12. Romans 12 turns to our present worship of God in light of everything he's done. Therefore, by the mercies of God, nothing good described into the letter up to this point is based on human effort or merit. In other words, we didn't earn any of it. There's no way we could achieve it. It's by his mercy. Everything described, you know, in that summary statement was the mercies of God. So now present yourselves. Nothing good described. So the metaphor then is that the glove. We have to be open. ourselves to be at God's mercy. Open up to him, okay? Then present your bodies to God, a living and holy sacrifice. Unlike the Israelites' continual sacrifices year after year. Think about that, the sacrificial system. When did they have to make a sacrifice? When they sinned. So they're making sacrifices continually year after year. So what must have been happening? They were sinning continually year after year. But Christ was our once-for-all sacrifice. So he's saying, rest in that. If you receive that, then all there is to do is to present yourself. No longer need for a sacrifice like Old Testament Israel. Again, they were stuck in their traditions. There was no transformation. And he says, the next thing, acceptable to God, the next phrase. So we have assurance in Christ that we will be accepted. It's not through our effort, not through our merit, but it's through Christ's once for all perfect sacrifice that he accomplished for us. Okay? We have to rest in that. We have to bend to that. Receive it. Okay? That's all. And then, next phrase, which is your spiritual service of worship? God is looking for spiritual service. That's interesting to me, a spiritual service of worship. That comes from a heart of faith. He's not just looking for religious acts. I mean, that was Old Testament Israel. They were caught up in their religious acts. We can get caught up in that in Christianity too, I think. I've seen lots of different types of churches. I've been part of different churches. You read about, you see on TV or whatever. There's a lot of different ways people worship God, but what matters is that it's a spiritual service of worship, okay? It's not so much about what we are doing. Like I said earlier, it's not about what we can do for him. It's about being flexible, being submitted to the life that is in us, okay? And then I was thinking about the word worship. So that the spiritual aspect is not just what we do. But then worship itself, the word, comes from the Old English worth-ship. That which I ascribe all worth. What's worthy of my time, of my attention, my efforts, everything. Whatever I am spending time on the most, thinking about the most, that is what I'm worshiping. Everybody worships something. We have to keep that in mind. In Romans 1, it talks about how they worshiped and served the creation or the creature rather than the creator. So humankind has been doing that from the beginning, worshiping something other than God, who we were made to worship. We were created in God's image and likeness to share in his life. If you think about Adam and Eve, they were created in God's image and likeness. They were in the Garden of Eden, walking with God. It actually says in Genesis 3, after they had sinned, they heard God walking in the garden. So, the tree of life was there in the garden. They had everything they needed. A relationship with God himself, who was walking in the garden with them. But what did they want? They wanted to be like God, taking from that tree of the knowledge of good and evil. But on their own terms. They wanted to be like God apart from God. Being able to be a God to themselves, basically. So I'd say in a way, they worship and serve themselves. Okay? So, worship, and I've also heard, I like this definition of worship. Someone once said, it's conforming myself to that which I adore. It's not just these acts. It's actually learning to live this life, submitting to that life, the one who has given it to us. What do I adore is the question then. Okay. In this case, worshiping next phrase in Romans 12, 1 and 2. And do not be conformed to this world. So, like I mentioned, you know, everybody is worshiping something. Which is, am I worshiping created things as those described in Romans 1? Or the Creator? So that is how I used to live before being born again of the Spirit as a child of God. The warning here is don't look back to that former life. Okay? So we as Christians should look different than the people around us. It's a different type of life, an eternal life, the very life of Christ. Okay? Then he says, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. The transformation occurs then from the inside out. Renewing of our mind is not just a one-time experience. As I was reflecting on this, I was realizing that it's a daily thing. As we seek the Lord, read His Word, as we pray, as we experience fellowship with other believers, like we are today. You know, it shouldn't just be a once-a-week thing, but this refreshes us, doesn't it? We're recharged for the week. And we need to continually keep it in mind. Take to heart what God is speaking to us. So that way, it's always with us. He is always with us. That's the reality. But then we'll have more of a revelation and understanding of how He's with us as we have our minds renewed more and more. And that will transform the way we live then. Instead of being conformed to the world, we transform outwardly. So again, we already have the life of Christ. It's not like I can do anything to add to that life. It's just being manifested. As I submit to that, work be done. The hand, the Lord, will show this world something different through our lives. Okay? So, it's by the strength the Holy Spirit supplies, not our own effort. Keep that in mind. And then, the last phrase of Romans 12, 1 and 2. So that you may prove what the will of God is. That which is good and acceptable and perfect. God has called us to holy living. Okay? His will is good and acceptable and perfect. But living in holy sacrifice, right? So living implies that it's a sacrifice that is continual. It's one sacrifice that, like, I'm walking around. It's a sacrifice as I submit to that life. And, you know, Abraham was the example. He went out not knowing where he was going. So, wherever the hand wants to take the glove doesn't fully understand, but it trusts. Okay? That's the life we're called to. God is holy. He's above all else. He's completely separate and distinct from His creation. And He's called us to holy living. So we should also be separate and distinct from this dead world around us. You know, we were driving around yesterday and the day before. It's so beautiful around here. We love the Appalachian Mountains. It's hard to remember sometimes that this world is dead. It's dying. It's in the process of and that can be hard to come to grips with sometimes. I understand that. Especially as I attach myself to certain things, whatever those things might be. But He's asking us to let go. It's like this stiff glove, instead of not being able to bend, it has this grip. It's not going to let go of whatever it has a grip on against the will of God. Respect. His will is perfect. We need to submit to it. In other words, be soft in the Creator's hands. That's what Paul is trying to say in Romans. That's the message. Be soft in the Creator's hands. What does this mean for us as the church, then? So like Old Testament Israel. I already pointed that out. They had their own customs, their own idea of what it meant to serve God, the creator of the universe. Somehow, they were stiff in the Lord's hands. But we can share that attitude as well, whether we realize it or not. You know, we shouldn't remove ourselves too quickly. Again, the warning in Romans was, you don't be proud as God's chosen people. But fear God. He is the one who's working mightily in a way that we don't understand. You know, Pastor Curtis had been preaching on Psalm 139 about the attributes of God, how he's omnipotent, omniscient, and he's everywhere. So how's that to make you fear God? It's not just he's around us, he's in us now. So he's looking for us to become more like him because he wants to reach others as well. That he would be glorified. It's all about his glory, right? So the second quote then represents the person with faith. Faith is just saying, okay, yes, Lord, have your way in my life. I'll bend. Presented themselves fully to God. Whatever you want to do, Lord. So are we like the first glove with clenched fist? Not opening up to the Lord. What are we holding on to that is against God's will? Are we conforming to this world? This world only serves itself. When we find ourselves thinking about ourselves the most, what's best for me? What I need to do to accomplish my goals for my life. Maybe there's something wrong there. I know in the past, and I still struggle with this, trying to figure out my own life. Why am I here in Pennsylvania this weekend? You know, I don't fully understand. I'm trying to have a soft heart, and I'm trying to see that we're all here for a reason. I don't fully understand that, but we need to understand that God is doing a mighty work. It's just a trust in our Creator, okay? So then some specific application. There are three groups of people I was thinking about. I don't know everybody here. I don't know listening on the live stream, obviously. The first group, were those not yet committed to Christ. We have to understand that if we're living life our own way, it's actually death. In Ephesians chapter 2, it just came to my mind, that he says, we were dead in our sins and trespasses in which we formerly walked, according to the course of this world, to the power of the air, of the spirit that is now working in the sons of disobedience. So in other words, in which we walked, that's saying a way of life, which was actually death. And we were by nature children of wrath, he says just after that. So we have to remember that God is a wrathful God. He's loving and he's wrathful. How could he not hate that which would corrupt that which he loves? It's hard for people to swallow sometimes that God can actually hate, that he can actually be wrathful. But how's that to make us fear God? To love him, knowing that he's loving, but there's also wrath. So, are you a child of wrath is the question. That's a way to be stiff in the Lord's hands. Not even opening up to him yet. So let's remember that. The second group of people, those who've made a recent commitment to the Lord. Are you ready to go deeper? Again, in eternal life. Who fully understands the eternal life? The life of Christ? I don't. None of us do, right? 1 John says, you know, we will perfectly know as we are known. But we don't yet. In the meantime, let's present ourselves to God. Be open to whatever he wants to do. To go deeper. It's not just that God God is this Lord, and he wants to do with me, he wants to wear me out, then he's going to cast me aside, you know, like this glove. He's done with me. No. He wants us to enjoy him. He's our Father. He's called us children. It's not just this religiosity. It's, again, this new life we've received. To enjoy him. To have a fuller revelation of who we are in him. There's nothing better, folks. I want to know more to you. Praise God. And he will show himself to us. He will. He's faithful. He's preparing us for something, isn't he? It's not about this life. The church is called the Bride of Christ. So he is working in our midst to prepare us for a day when we will be presented to him. Right? So Paul is saying in Romans 12, present yourselves to God a living and holy sacrifice. One day we will be finally fully presented to him. We'll see him face to face. So let's be in the practice of presenting ourselves to him now, is basically what Paul is saying. Have your way in us, God. There's enjoyment in it. There's joy even in the midst of suffering. Right? It talks about, especially I think of Romans 8, where he talks about there's so much suffering we're going to experience, but we overwhelmingly conquer through Christ's love, through his life in us, by the power of the Spirit. And then the third group of people. Those who have been following the maybe have a deeper understanding of God's word. What are you holding on to that might make you stiff in the Lord's hands? Are there certain traditions, customs, habits, an understanding that I think I have this down? Are we stiff? I mean, we're still God's love, so to speak. We're still his people. He's wanting a soft heart, isn't he? He wants us to experience him at a deeper level, more fully. Is there a love for worldly things in the church? Paul warns Timothy. We're studying Timothy this morning. We've been studying Timothy. He warns that in the last days, mockers will themselves Christians. They'll even call themselves Christian teachers. But they'll think that godliness is a means of gain. In other words, being a Christian or doing Christian things, religious things, and I'll get some sort of worldly gain out of it. That is not why God has made us his children. Remember what he says at the end of Romans 11, to the glory of God forever. It's about his glory. We should always be pointing to that in everything we do. Now, it's a sanctification process, meaning God is making us more like him. It's a process. We will never have arrived, any of us, in this life. So we need to constantly, continually present ourselves to God, a living and holy sacrifice. So as long as we're living on earth, we should be a living sacrifice. Right? And that's a challenge, I know. I'm not doing it perfectly. So then, the word of caution. I just felt like the Lord was putting this on me specifically. Just because we're doing spiritual-looking things does not mean we are doing God's will. God's will is good and acceptable and perfect. But we might be doing something different than the person sitting right next to us. Just because I'm involved in such and such program, event, group, whatever it might be. Just because I worship God in this manner, you know, with my hands raised, or I use a hymnal, or whatever. Is it according to God's will, is what is important. We have to be open to being changed, transformed, in the words of Paul, as we have our minds renewed. So we will have our lives transformed in radical ways as we present ourselves to God. Okay? You can fully understand the work of the Spirit. with, you know, we've been in house church ministry, and we can talk about that a little more later. But just because we're doing things like the early church did it, so to speak, doesn't mean we're more spiritual. God is doing a new thing. God's Spirit is working in different ways. You think about, too, I read about missionaries in different areas of the world. It looks different what they're doing. Same God, though, same Holy Spirit working through them. We have the same Word of God. He's given us the same promises. I mentioned Abraham. He saw the same city which God is preparing for us, too. In Hebrews 11, it says they didn't receive those promises yet. But together with us, they will be perfected. We will all receive that together as God's people, as His children. Last thing, I really feel like I should emphasize, it's all for God's glory. For me, I don't know about you all, but I like when I get attention. It feels good, in a certain respect, doesn't it? And it's not bad that you would get attention. I mean, God draws people to Himself through our lives. We have to understand that the end that people would turn to Christ, that we would know the Lord more, that He would be glorified in His church. So again, let's not be stiff in the Lord's hands. Look at this. It looks like it received that oil. It's flexible enough now to use. So I did not cast aside my glove forever. Now we can work together. We might look different in exactly what we're doing. The same life is in us. So let's submit to that. Present ourselves daily. Have our minds renewed through prayer, through fellowship, the reading of His Word, and really seeking an understanding of who He is. We are children of God. Praise the Lord. So let's worship Him accordingly. So again, I pointed out those three groups of people. Think about what group maybe you're in. Allison and I are going to lead you in a song, some worship here. A time to reflect. A time for us to think about maybe how we're stiff in the